Now, following on from that, joining me now is a special guest, and it's Katy Bourne, the Sussex Police and Crime Commissioner. Welcome to you.
Thank you for having me.
How nice to see you. It's the first time you've been on with me.
It is.
You have been here before, though.
No, I haven't actually been to the studio.
I thought you had.
I've done a few outside broadcasts for latest TV, well, quite a few, but never actually to the studio. So it's really impressive.
Welcome.
And the public can't see the bar, can
they? I know. Please see, we've got the Palace Pier behind us.
I've been at the bar.
You've been at the bar.
I've got the water.
Only water, by the way.
I hope so, because it's rather a lot if it isn't.
A couple of things have come up, and thank you so much for coming in. I know you've been very, very busy. You're always accessible. Is that has always been your policy?
Yes. I want to be as accessible as I possibly can be. Part of the criticism that was levelled against the old police authority that I replaced was that nobody knew they were there. So, you know, by virtue of that, I need to be out there and so the public can get hold of me whenever, wherever.
Unfortunately, I've got so much to ask you about and such little time to do it, so
we'll see what we can do.
We'll dive in there. First of all, let's go on to the story that's just broken today, where an MP would like to see the combination of three forces coming together. How would you feel about that?
There's been a lot of call for this recently. I think the Police Federation in particular have been quite vocal about merging forces together and having regional or national forces. I'm not a great believer in that because I think that we can actually be more effective if we collaborate more. And certainly as a region at the moment, the five forces, so Kent, Surrey, Sussex, Hampshire and Thames Valley, work at a regional level around organised crime. At the moment, four forces are looking at doing back office functions and merging those. So there's a lot that we can do at a regional level without having to actually merge forces. Because what the public tell me, and obviously this has got to be led by the public, but what they're telling me at the moment is they really value their local police. They like the feel of that sort of neighbourhood local policing. That's really important.
Yeah, because of funding. We're seeing police stations close. We're seeing, I heard the other day at PCSOs in Lansing, for example, will be going. Almost one left out of three.
Well, yeah, Sussex Police has got to find cuts the same as other forces. There's public sector organisations, local authorities are in the same boat. And we've been told to model budgets to expect anything up to 40% cuts. So, you know, unfortunately, we are where we are and we have to fund the deficit that the country's in. But I don't think in Sussex, when you say police stations are closing, some have closed, but I've made an absolute guarantee to the public that I will not close a police station unless something similar or better is in its place. So what we are doing is where there's stations that are out of public areas where people don't necessarily go to, we're selling those off and reinvesting that money. So opening up community hubs, police hubs in libraries, in council buildings, and here in Brighton and Hove, £13 million investment in John Street. So we're actually investing in the bigger police stations because that's what the public want to see.
And what about the criticism about opening hours?
Well, again, you know, it's got to be evidence-based. If the station isn't being used as often, then what is the value of it to the community? Can that station be in a better place where the community can access it more effectively? So if we look at Hove, for example, where we sold the police station there and moved into Hove Town Hall, the front desk is actually open every day for an hour and a half longer. It's easier and cheaper to run. So the public have greater access than they did with the old police station. And we sold the police station to the local authority who've opened it up as a school. Desperately crying out for school places in the area. So a real win, I think, all round. So it's about being sensible with the police estate, really. It's not about closing everything and selling it all off. It's about closing those that aren't used and reinvesting it in the police stations that need the investment, hence the huge investment in John Street.
I mean, the other thing was mentioned at the beginning there about amalgamation, possibly of three police forces. There was a suggestion also quite recently that the fire, police and ambulance should come under one umbrella as well.
There's a lot of talk at the moment, and there's around the devolution bill as well. Local authorities are looking at how they can get more devolved powers. And so certainly I know that East Sussex County, West Sussex County and Surrey County Council are looking at a three-county solution as well. So it's really, I think we're all looking at ways that we can work more effectively together. We talk a lot about partnership working, but I haven't seen huge amounts of that up until now. now. So it's been a case of, well, we all work in partnership as long as you do what I want, type of thing. But of course now, where we are, it's forcing people to look at how they can be more effective together. So whether that's combining stations, so East Sussex Fire and Rescue Service are coming into the main police headquarters in Lewes very soon. So, you know, amalgamating their services together there, which will see much greater working and flexibility that way. I think it will be difficult to bring ambulance in because they're very much seen as a health side of things. But certainly there is talk about fire and rescue services and the new bill that's coming out, I think, next month, the new policing bill, will certainly show that police and crime commissioners and local authorities have a duty to collaborate with the fire and rescue. And they've said that in certain areas, if you want to merge, then they're willing to help with that, if, mm-hmm. if that's... But for me, it's always about, you know, what's in the public interest? Is it the right thing for people? And that's why I try and be as accessible as I can, so I can listen to what the public want. The great thing about Sussex is they do tell you what they think.
I'm sure, yes. And you hold a lot of these public meetings, don't you, as well?
I do.
People can tell you what they want.
Absolutely.
What they think.
We had some really successful one in Brighton here with the Chief Constable, where he and Chief Superintendent Nev Kemp, who's the local divisional commander, they were there on the stage. The public could come in and question them in sort of the good old-fashioned way of the public hall meetings. But also, we use a lot of social media. So we're on Twitter and on Facebook and so on, under the Talk Sussex programme. And the accountability meetings that I hold with the chief, where you can see me actually question him and ask him the questions the public want to ask.
How'd you get on with him? We
tweet those out. How do I get on with the chief constable? I think the relationship is professional. Mm-hmm. Because at the end of the day, you know, I am responsible for appointing the chief constable and, if necessary, dismissing. And you have to remember that relationship needs to be maintained professionally. Mr. York, Giles York, is a really good chief constable. He's very passionate about his job. He really cares about people, which is fantastic. Mm-hmm. And he cares about his staff, his officers and staff, yeah, as well.
Are you in a position where you could fire him if you wanted to?
Yes.
You are?
I appointed him last year. Mm-hmm. I think, though, if you get to the point where you're having to fire someone, and this is true in any walk of life, then the relationship is really broken down.
Yeah.
So for me, it's about keeping those lines of communication open. You know, he's a chief constable. I don't want to do his job. He spent 30 years doing his job. He knows it a lot better mm-hmm. than I do. But my job is to scrutinise what he does, to challenge him and to support him as well. Because after all, let's face it, we want Sussex Police to be even better than they are, because it means we'll all be safe.
Yeah. Let's move on to yourself. Unfortunately, we haven't got a lot of time, so let's all dive into emergencies now. Sure. We had, of course, the Shoreham Air Show disaster, yes, where the police, there's lots of accolades that come out over the last few weeks, of course, and awards have been given out. You must have felt very proud with the reaction by the emergency services.
Oh, the emergency services were amazing. I mean, everybody, the amount of praise that came back was incredible. But they all work together. They have a joint emergency services interoperability programme. Did I say that right? JESIP. And it shows, really came into its own with this emergency. So whichever emergency service is first on the scene takes on that mantle. And then as so first of all, it was, I think it was fire and rescue. And then once it wasn't, once there weren't any casualties, as it were, you know, there weren't any living casualties, it then became a police matter and they took over. And everybody just works seamlessly. Nobody questions. So whoever's in charge gives the orders and all the other services fall in line. And also the Red Cross and loads of organisations that played their part. Mm-hmm. Was fantastic.
And the public, certainly around Shoreham, took the police force to their hearts, didn't they?
They really did, yes. Mm. I mean, at the end of the day, you know, you hear the stories about policing nationally, and they do get quite a bashing in the national press. And for all the faults that locally, though, people do value their police. They really do value, and Sussex Police are held in great esteem by the members of the public.
And you can't train a policeman or a policewoman to deal with a disaster like this, or what they're going to see when they get there.
Well, they do train for these operations, and certainly the local resilience forum that's run by the county council have overall control of that, is where all the organisations come together, and they practice every year around some big emergency that would happen, because they need to know that everything, we need to know as members of the public, that everything will work if there is an emergency. And clearly it works well, because that was shown in the Shoreham air disaster. We don't want too many of those, though. Awful events. And there's a big memorial service this Sunday in Lancing College for families and for all the emergency services who will be there and coming together.
I assume you'll be there.
I'll be there too. Yes.
Along with Tim Lawton as well.
Yes, Tim Lawton, local MP, and actually so will Peter Kyle, who's the MP for Hove, and Maria Caulfield, the MP for Lewis, because I understand that unfortunately some of the family. Some of the people that were killed were members of their constituencies as well. Really, really tragic, but an opportunity, I think, for the emergency services to come together and really pay their respects.
Quick break, if you don't mind. Sure. You don't mind hanging around for the last part of the programme, do you? You're watching Latest TV News live here in the heart of Brighton. My name's Mike Mendoza. I'm joined by Katy Bourne, the Police and Crime Commissioner. Back after the break. Welcome back to Latest TV News. I'm still joined, of course, by Katy Bourne, the Police and Crime Commissioner. What do you like to be called? Do you like to be called Commissioner or...?
I prefer to be called Katy.
Oh, really?
Definitely. I think if we're in a public meeting and it's terribly formal, and especially if it's with the Chief Constable, then I tend to call him Mr. York, and he refers to me as Commissioner or Mrs. Bourne. But apart from that, no, we're not with the public. Please call me Katy.
OK, Katy. Let's move on now to the terrible events that happened in Paris on Friday night. If that happened here, would we be able to cope with it? Is Sussex Police geared up for any sort of terrorism?
Well, I think, first of all, it's to give the public reassurance that there's no information or indication that the threat level has changed in Sussex or in this country. So it remains severe, which means that an attack is highly likely, but not imminent.
Mm-hmm.
That would be, if the police had intelligence to show that attack would be imminent, then the threat level would increase. But it remains at severe, which is, you know, severe is severe.
Mm-hmm.
So the police are on their guard, and that's really to give public reassurance. It hasn't changed. But what happens in Sussex is, since the Mumbai attacks, the police have trained for this, and they've been properly, you know, trained, and they practice these events. So if anything like that did happen in Sussex, you have locally trained firearms officers who are on call 24 hours a day, and that would be coordinated locally. And if they needed to, there would be a regional and a national response as well. So Sussex could call on other forces for help if necessary. But I think from the public's point of view, the reassurance is that, you know, nothing has changed at the moment, and it remains severe. What they've done, though, in London, in and around London, is to give more reassurance for the public. They've increased police presence.
So around police.
Public events and sports events and stuff like that. So just to give, well, it's more of a visibility to give the public confidence.
Yeah. I mean, last night, I think for the first time, we saw almost paramilitary police, which is like we haven't seen in this country before, with their own special uniform, it said police on their backs, all very, very well armed. Are we going to see that in Sussex?
Well, I mean, not unless there was a need, and let's hope we don't need to. But clearly, you know, you have these counter-terrorist specialist firearms officers who are trained specially, you just referred to, and that's since the Mumbai terrorist attack. So, you know, that capability is there. But every year, the chief constables do a threat risk and harm assessment, and they come together, and there is a national police lead for this as well. And it's their job as chief constables, because this is an operational decision, to make sure they've got the resources around this. And so it's a very dynamic risk assessment. Mm-hmm. They look at it every year and they change it accordingly. But, you know, and my role as a police and crime commissioner is to make sure to question the chief constable and to give the public that reassurance. And I'll be doing that this week at our accountability meeting, which we webcast live, just to ask him that he's confident that he has the resources and the capability should he require it. But it's really, it's a tiered response. So there are firearms officers that can be called on 24 hours a day in Sussex. And if necessary, there's a regional and a national tiered response.
There was an incident, of course, at Gatwick last weekend.
Yes. Yes.
Were you sort of kept informed of what was going on there?
I was. Anything of real importance for the public like that, then I am kept fully informed.
Mm-hmm.
And if necessary, if I have to go out to the public and give that reassurance, I will. But, at the moment, things haven't changed, so there's no intelligence, there's no information to say that the threat level has changed in Sussex or in the UK. But it remains at severe. And, of course, the public are vital in this. You know, it's important important that they keep vigilant, and if they do see anything suspicious, any activity, please to report it. There is a terrorist hotline number. It's an 0800 number. I don't know it off the top of my head, but I can give it to you for later if you've got a way of telling people. But you know, other than that, they can ring 999 in an emergency, and obviously there's always the 101 non-emergency number.
Yeah. Gatwick, again, is that the most armed area in Sussex?
To my knowledge, yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. I mean, obviously, there are, with the radicalisation programme that the government run, the PREVENT programme is about preventing that in communities, and that's very much led by local authorities. And so we have a couple of areas in Sussex, Brighton and Crawley, where there is an extra sort of bit of caution and care there from the local authorities. But Gatwick is probably the main area.
Do you work fairly closely with the security forces?
I don't work closely with them because obviously I'm not a trained officer, but I am aware of what goes on. We get regular briefings as police and crime commissioners. The head of counter-terrorism is briefing us next week at our annual meeting, where all the chief constables will be and all the police and crime commissioners. I'm not sure what you call a collective of police and crime commissioners, maybe a handcuff or a cell or something. But there's everybody in the country will be at this particular meeting, and we will get fully briefed.
Isn't it? I've got that number if anyone would like to make a note of this. It's the anti-terrorist hotline number, which is 0800 789 321. That's 0800 789 321. Katie's writing it down now.
Yeah, I did know it, but I didn't want to quote it in case I got it wrong. So I'm glad you got it. Thank you.
Pretty close. So what changes have you made, and what changes would you like to see made for the future?
In policing in Sussex?
Yep.
Well, I think the police are held to account very effectively. I think it's very transparent the way they work. The public can see me question the chief around various issues. And certainly from a safety point of view, I've worked really hard with the chief and his senior officers around the vulnerability of people, particularly around child abuse, domestic abuse in particular. And I'd like to continue in that work. I also have responsibilities around commissioning services for victims of crime. So if you're a victim in Sussex of crime and you need extra support, any counselling or help, my job is to ensure that that's there for you, and you know where to go to look for it as well. Mm-hmm. So now as a police and crime commissioner, we have a 3-year contract which we've given to victim support. And they deliver those services for us across the county. And they also give every victim of crime information about restorative justice, which is another area that I have responsibility for. So that's where you bring a victim together with an offender. If the victim wants to meet the offender, the perpetrator of the crime, they can. And they know where to go. There are 20 organisations now across the county that deliver this. And Brighton and Hove is looking at becoming a restorative justice city, which is fantastic. It's all about the prevention of crime, really.
You're the very first crime commissioner that was appointed for Sussex, and your term of office ends next year.
It does.
Would you want to carry on?
I do, and I have the Conservative Party nomination now to stand again as their candidate. So once we get into the purdah period next year, the 6 weeks in the run-up to the election in May, I will be out knocking on doors on the campaign trail. I'm not sure who my opponents will be on that, who the other candidates are, we don't know.
Should it be political?
Yes, because priorities for policing were always set nationally by the government through the Home Secretary. Now they're set locally through a politician, but they reflect what local people want. So they're not national priorities anymore, they're local priorities. And so I am a politician by virtue of the fact that I'm elected by the public to be their voice, to be their representative. But I don't politicise the police because it's really important that I keep the politics side out of it. I'm there to represent 1.6 million people, mm-hmm. regardless of whether they voted for me or not, regardless of whether they vote or not, and just the same as any Member of Parliament would as well. And I'm really, really aware of that, and I go to great pains to make sure that there's no politics in the policing.
Around the country, so many commissioners have been criticised, many saying, well, it's a useless position, it shouldn't happen. But that hasn't happened in Sussex. You've obviously hit the right chord, I think, most of the time.
Oh, I don't know. I think there's always criticisms. You know, it's true in any public office. If you stick your head above the parapet, people will always have an opinion, and that's absolutely their right. And we live in a democratic society which allows people that freedom of speech, which is fantastic. But no, I think the thing is, my job is to really let the public see what the role is about, and to help them to understand what it means for them, because I represent the biggest reform to policing this country's ever seen. Whereas before you had, as I said, policing priorities set by the government, now they're set locally by me. So for the first time ever, local people have a real say in the policing that matters to them, so they can really affect change. And if they don't like the decisions I make, if they don't like the direction the police are going in, they can change that at the ballot box. They never had that opportunity before. They had no way of getting rid of the previous police authority because they were never directly elected to that position. But I am. So if they don't like it, they can vote for someone else. So a massive change for people, really important to them. And that's why, for me, I'm quite passionate about it. And hopefully the public will see that.
Well, what's the biggest issue that people come to you with?
There are many. There are many issues. Sometimes it can be the complaints system. They're not happy with the way they've been dealt with. They're not happy with the way the police have dealt with their complaint. It can be a whole manner of things. I mean, I speak to the public all the time, and some of the cases are really sensitive. I've spoken to victims of abuse who've had a fantastic service from the police and just want to talk and say thank you. I've spoken to people who've had problems with elderly relatives who've been in care and not been looked after, and they're not happy with the response that all the services bring, and so on. It can be a whole manner of things.
Katy, thank you so much for coming in. I appreciate that.
Pleasure.
Thank you so much for inviting me.
Do have me back.
Good luck. That's Katy Bourne, the Police and Crime Commissioner, and good luck to her. She stands again next year. Good luck to you. That's about it from us here at Latest TV News. I'll be here again 6 o'clock for the roundup of all today's news. We'll be right back.